And I'll speak about probiotics in the prevention of antibiotic-associated side effects. When prescribing antibiotics, we know that they are without clinical complication. They are not without clinical complication. Indeed, even a one-time antibiotic treatment may disturb the intestinal microbial balance, resulting in a range of gastrointestinal side effects, such as abdominal distension, abdominal pain, and more commonly, diarrhea. Antibiotic-associated diarrhea has been recently defined by the World Health Organization as otherwise unexplained diarrhea that occurs in association with the administration of antibiotics. The incidence in children ranges from 11 to 40%, with diarrhea in hospitalized patients immunodepressed in the elderly age with the use of broad-spectrum antibiotic and with combined and prolonged antibiotic therapy. The spectrum of clinical symptoms vary from a mild diarrhea to a fulminant colitis with severe dehydration and possibly death, generally associated with decolonization by Clostridium difficile. Almost all antibiotics can cause diarrhea, although the risk is higher with the cephalosporins, the association of amoxicillin and clavulanate, and clindamycin. This antibiotic can cause diarrhea by several mechanisms, although in the majority percent of cases, they decrease the concentration of intestinal anaerobes, leading to either metabolic consequences, such as a reduced digestion of carbohydrates and the resultant osmotic diarrhea, either to overgrowth of other enteric pathogens, such as in the minority percent of cases, the Clostridium difficile, with a toxin-mediated enteric disease. And this results in a substantial economic burden with a long period of hospitalization, a higher cost of rate, an increased incidence of other nosocomial infection, and a higher mortality. Thus, there is considerable interest in measures capable of prevent or ameliorate this condition. And in this perspective, probiotics may have a role because, first of all, they restore the balance in the intestinal tract, and they are also reported to display a non-immunological antimicrobial effect and an immunoregulatory effect. In fact, they produce antimicrobial substances that may inhibit both the growth of gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. They may also compete with pathogens for the adherence to epithelial and mucosal receptors. They compete for nutrients. They stabilize the barrier function by restoring permeability and increasing mucus production. Moreover, they may also modify the immune response of the host by stimulating the production of anti-inflammatory cytokine and by enhancing both the humoral and cell-mediated immunity. To eradicate HP, we need of a proton pump inhibitor plus two of the following antibiotics, variably associated and given twice daily from 7 to 15 days. And thus, it is well known that this is a really interesting field to test a probiotic because this is a combined therapy with different classes of antibiotics and a prolonged therapy. Thinking so, our group recently performed a randomized clinical trial to evaluate the effect of Lactobacillus reuteri to reduce the overall burden of antibiotic side effect during anti-H. pylori therapy. To this aim, we enrolled all the 40 children, H. pylori positive children, blindly randomized to receive reuteri or placebo during the 10 days of sequential therapy and for the following 10 days of follow-up. In order to determine the type and severity of gastrointestinal symptoms, children completed at entry on day 10 and on day 20 the gastrointestinal symptom rating scale. That is a validated questionnaire to evaluate all gastrointestinal symptoms comprising 50 items describing abdominal pain, abdominal distension, diarrhea, and constipation. And these are our results. As you see, in all children supplemented with probiotics, there was a significant reduction of the gastrointestinal symptom rating scale score at the end of therapy, markedly evident at the end of follow-up. And if we look for any specific symptoms, we see that children receiving reuteri complained less frequently of epigastric pain during the therapy and during the follow-up of abdominal distension, diarrhea, eructation, and halitosis, showing an overall good impact of reuteri on antibiotic-associated side effects. Moreover, no differences there was in treatment schedules and H. pylori eradication treatment, and no adverse event was reported. Thus, there is compelling evidence to support the use of probiotics in the prevention of AVD, although specific strain and doses with strong evidence of efficacy are recommended. And considering that for every 10 patients treated with an antibiotics, one fewer will develop diarrhea if also receive probiotics, future study would address the cost effectiveness of this primary prophylaxis, remembering that the judicious use of antibiotics remains the best tool of prevention. Thank you for the attention.